Thank you, Matthijs. That was a great presentation. I learned a lot as well. So thank you to you both. So as Matthijs mentioned, I'm Patrick McIlhone. I'm an associate lawyer here at Gowling WLG's Hamilton office, and I will be hosting the next session, which will go from 11 to 12 a.m. Just a reminder that if you've joined us late, your microphone and camera will be turned off during this presentation stage mode. But after this session, there will be a networking session where you'll see a room where you can move to different tables and connect with speakers or other hosts in order to ask additional questions or just to make some connections yourselves. So this next session we've titled The Convergence of Lending and Technology. And this is a focus on intellectual property assets, and in particular, lending on the basis of the value of and the security of IP assets. So we've broken this down into three sessions that we thought made sense to give our audience the full perspective of all stakeholders involved in transactions, lending transactions that involve IP. So first we'll be speaking with Michael Wong, who is a scientist and entrepreneur in the biotech startup space, about launching, scaling, and operating an IP-heavy startup. And he's gonna give us a better understanding of what's happening on the ground from the business and entrepreneur founder side when they're trying to get their businesses off the ground. So next we'll be speaking with a veteran in the investment and lending space, Lally Rementilla, a veteran who will be talking to us about valuing and financing IP from a lender's perspective. And finally, we'll have our very own Alex Ross, counsel and patent agent at Gowling WLG, to delve into securing and protecting trademarks, patents, trade secrets, and other forms of IP. So as Matthijs mentioned, I will be watching the Q&A and the chat if you have any questions in the meantime. So feel free and we'll try to put them to our speakers. So I see Michael's joined us, and thank you, Michael, for giving us your time today. Michael's a scientist by training and entrepreneur by practice. He has a PhD in placental biology at McMaster University and a Master of Science in Physiology and Pharmacology at Western University. I took a look at Michael's academic and scientific background, and it's chock full of prestigious scholarships and awards. So I'll spare him further blushing on that here and get into his sort of post-science and academic career. So Michael founded his first company in 2008, which was where he was involved in raising capital, building and leading teams, product development, and establishing relationships with external stakeholders. Michael's currently a senior associate at Flagship Pioneering out of Boston, Massachusetts. He works as part of a venture creation team to ideate, launch, scale, and operate biotech startups. Michael's also on the advisory panel for McMaster Innovation Park here in Hamilton, which is a research and innovation park supporting startups, businesses, research, and the commercialization of IP. So I thought we'd start with Michael giving us a high-level view of the life cycle of a tech, and specifically a biotech startup, from idea to broad commercialization and actual profitability. To give our audience a full picture of the business and development side of these companies and how they view their IP and protecting it and valuing it before we look at the lender's side. So thanks again, Michael, for joining us, and take it away.
Thank you, Patrick. And thanks, Gowling, as well for inviting me. I understand that I come from a fairly different background, I think, from most people in the audience. So, you know, hopefully I'm able to shed a little bit of light into the entrepreneurship process, into you know, the background of building tech and biotech companies, and I think be able to tie some of these concepts back to the importance and value of establishing a strong IP portfolio, and how lenders can think about that as well. So next slide, please. As Patrick mentioned, I was more of a lab rat. I was a scientist for about 10 years and involved in entrepreneurship on the side as well. Born and raised in Canada, but now I live in Boston, where I work at Flagship Pioneering. For those who are unfamiliar with the firm, Flagship is a life sciences venture firm. We're a little bit different from your traditional VC in that we no longer invest in external founders, but we are actually the inventors and founders of our own companies within our portfolio. And I'll explain a little bit more what I mean by that. Next slide, please. So we've been in business for about 20 years now at Flagship. starting off as a more traditional investment firm, but in recent years transitioned almost entirely to a venture creation model, where essentially all the companies that you see in our portfolio now, we were actually the founders of those companies and carrying them through from initial inception of ideation all the way to a growth and scaling biotech company that would employ more than 1,000 people and have products in the pipeline. So, you know, we see through the entire life cycle of a biotech company from initial idea in a lab all the way to the formation of an actual company. Next slide, please. And this is one slide that I actually wanted to spend a little bit more time on, just because I think that this, while this is the process that we undertake at Flagship in pushing through ideas all the way to a growth company, in many ways, this reflects the life cycle of your average biotech company too. Biotech companies, I would say, are fairly different from, I think, your average industry company, even quite different from your tech company, in that a lot of the times, at least for the first, you know, 3 to 5, if not longer than that, the value of a biotech company is fundamentally built almost entirely into the IP that it's able to create, and as well the team that it's able to assemble to do that. So I'll walk through this slide slowly, and then I think get back to some of these points maybe in the discussion with Patrick at the end. But when we think about the life cycle and entrepreneurship process of a biotech company, from early idea all the way to spin out company, it starts usually at phase one, where within Flagship, we call these explorations. But outside of this, with any other founder, essentially, this is the process of the entrepreneur looking for an idea that they want to build a company around. They'll generate hypotheses, they'll explore literature, explore the space that academics are currently conducting research within. And then when they find an idea that's compelling enough for them, essentially they aim to raise the seed round entirely based upon, I think, the compelling nature of that idea that they're able to propose. And with the seed money, a lot of times that founders, like ourselves at Flagship, but outside as well, we use the seed money to essentially create the strategy and portfolio of patents that will essentially define the company. The scientific space that we want to stake claim into, the particular use cases and methods by which we hope to essentially create products around, and then also build the initial scientific team around the development of some of those ideas, running the experiments within our own labs, and actually identifying new scientific areas and filing those. Begin to build those portfolios up, and usually, you know, biotech companies are very secretive as well. They'll oftentimes operate under stealth for a lot of this early seed funding and, you know, IP creation, but oftentimes they'll unveil themselves when they begin to go raise the Series A, in which case we've seen a huge growth in terms of the amounts that biotech companies are raising these days at the Series A and beyond. But within Flagship, we call this the Phase 3 NewCo, where essentially, the company is now its own standalone venture. We begin to recruit the leadership team that will hopefully take and grow this company to become an independent entity and a self-sustaining entity, and begin to assemble the broader team that builds the legs of the company. And then eventually moving into phase four, which within Flagship terms is essentially a Series B and beyond, we hope to spin out this company, where Flagship as a venture group will begin to exit from the company. We'll invite on syndicate investors to join us with the continual raising of the funds, and the company will continue to operate and grow. But important to point out throughout this entire process, for many biotech companies, even by the time they reach the Series B and beyond, they may not have an actual product that they're selling to consumers. They may not be revenue positive, and oftentimes they aren't, especially in the context of companies that are developing therapeutic companies. So how do we identify value in these companies? How do we continue to create value as the founders? And also as investors, how do we recognize value as well? And a lot of the times, it's in the merit and strength of the science that that company is able to conduct, and the way that they're able to connect that science to the potential market that it's able to serve as well. And on the science side, that may be anything from a brand new therapeutic modality, an enhancement in an existing therapeutic modality. And recent years, we're seeing a huge insurgence of that with, for example, mRNA technologies, which prior to that, really, there were only a handful of players in that space. But now we see incredible value being assigned to this modality on its own, but then tying that as well to the markets that it's able to serve. No one would have imagined 10 years ago that you could take mRNA and create a vaccine against an infectious disease for it. But now this has been the technology that actually saved the world from COVID-19. So it's really important to be able to see that, you know, prior to this, and as companies like Moderna were raising value for itself, these products were not yet in existence until at least about 5 to 10 years post the creation of that company. Next slide, please. And this is just an example of the ecosystem that exists within Flagship, you know, along the entire spectrum of what I just talked about, from ideation all the way to spin out venture. But again, this is similar to an ecosystem that you may find in any city or any region as well. Boston in particular is a very prominent and well-established biotech ecosystem, but it's not hard to imagine how an ecosystem like this could be created within, say, Toronto or Ontario as well as a whole. And, you know, I'm particularly passionate about trying to talk through how we can imagine creating this. If you look at the Flagship ecosystem here, some of our more mature companies that we're showcasing, we founded about 10 years ago. And so within a 10-year span, we're able to create an ecosystem that contains hundreds of ideations that we're currently continuing to incubate within the minds across, you know, individuals at Flagship, spinning out to a handful of prototype companies that are operating within the seed stage, trying to raise and create value through the conducting of science and creation of IP, to the development of, you know, again, a handful of newcos or companies operating at the Series A, where they're essentially expanding, imagining out their product pipelines, beginning to recruit leadership teams, to the eventual spin out of a growth company or Series B and beyond company, where they're able to stand on their own legs, raise money on their own, and begin to create actual products that serve humanity. Next slide, please. And so with that said, I think with a showcase of that ecosystem, what I also want to do in the latter part of this presentation is just walk through a couple quick slides that I think showcase what it actually means to ideate upon a novel scientific idea and how we actually bring value to that idea and begin to imagine what it could look like as a company. Next slide, please. And this is a quote that the founder and CEO of Flagship, the firm I work at, Nubar, he often challenges us with. But again, this quote is, I think, more broadly applicable as well to the tech and biotech ecosystem as a whole. And especially, I think, to the ways that perhaps I would encourage lenders and investors to rethink how they identify value across this particular ecosystem. But Nubar often challenges us and says, why should we expect extraordinary results from reasonable people doing reasonable things? And as a Canadian myself, I think that a lot of the times we as Canadians fall into this trap in that we are conservative. We like to be reasonable people looking for reasonable places to do reasonable business. But when you consider this in the context of biotechnology, life sciences, or even high tech, these are startups that, in order to create maximal value for themselves, have to pursue ideas that are far beyond the adjacent concepts that exist within today's world. They have to pursue ideas that are moonshots that will revolutionize the world if the idea is able to materialize into something extraordinary. Next slide, please. And so the approach by which we take at Flagship, but as well, again, thinking more broadly across the biotech ecosystem as well, is that when we begin to search for an idea for a company that we try to create, we push ourselves to search for value beyond the adjacent concepts. We don't simply take a scientific paper at face value and immediately try to commercialize the immediate application that comes out of that. We oftentimes push ourselves to imagine what if a particular scientific finding could be applied across a broad spectrum of disease categories, could be transformed into a broad spectrum of modalities that could emerge from it, and could treat and address a number of different health diseases and areas that could, again, benefit humanity and our worlds. Next slide, please. And beyond pushing ourselves beyond adjacencies, a lot of times we at Flagship, and I think this is also a trend that's beginning to emerge in the biotech ecosystem as a whole too, is that we've begun to move beyond the classical approach where we say, take a particular target and then just try to create one drug against it and then build a company around that. The biotech ecosystem is beginning to shift towards trying to create a broader platform approach where we could say, take a suite of modalities or a method to create a new modality and apply that in a way that could address XYZ disease, so more than one disease as a whole. And this is part of the attribution to the, I think, larger rounds that we're beginning to see as well, but we're also beginning to see the value that this could have in pursuing a platform-based company as opposed to just a single modality company as well, and that, you know, science is a risky business, but if one indication doesn't work, our modality could still be applied to treating a second indication as well. Next slide, please. And in the last couple slides, I just want to walk through a case study of one of the companies that we created 10 years ago, Moderna Therapeutics, which I'm sure many of you are familiar with now. But even a company as large as Moderna is now today began with an initial scientific observation 10 years ago. And this is the way that almost all biotech companies begin. So again, an encouragement, I think, for lenders and investors that may not be as familiar with this space, that a lot of the times this is how we imagine and see value from its earliest stages. So with the example of Moderna, it always begins with the scientific observation. And there was a paper published back in 2010 out of the labs of Warren and Rossi that essentially demonstrated that you could take, for example, synthetically modified mRNA, which is the molecule that is now the same modality that's used in our COVID vaccines. But they took synthetic mRNA, put it into a cell, and essentially showed that they could take a cell and direct the differentiation of that cell. So take one particular cell type, transform it into another cell type. So you could take a stem cell, transform it into, say, a heart cell, for example. Super, super cool observation that they were able to find. But next slide, please. But if we simply took that classical approach to commercialization, took the short-term kind of exit in mind, the only perhaps application we could imagine is, say, to take that, again, that paper at face value, create synthetic mRNAs and try to reprogram and differentiate stem cells for various therapies. This would have been a really, really cool application, but this would not have been, I think, what Moderna is today. And so next slide, please. And so the platform approach is essentially asking the broader question as the founder, as the investor, instead of just taking the immediate application that's possible, what's the broader application we can imagine? What if we could actually take synthetic mRNA and teach ourselves to not only differentiate down a particular pathway, but actually teach ourselves to produce any type of protein? And in doing so, teach ourselves to actually prevent, treat, or cure any kind of disease as well. And these were the fundamental hypotheses that at the ideation stage launched into Moderna Therapeutics. Next slide, please. And so beyond that, taking this hypothesis, what is the value proposition we could imagine from this? This is where we need to begin to be willing to take leaps in what we can imagine this company to become, because biotech and technology companies are not like other industries where you can imagine an exit within 1 to 2 years. The long run is the appropriate execution and application of the science that we're able to create in the early years, and then finding the right leadership team to actually execute on the product development strategy. But if we could take mRNA, use it to teach ourselves to create any type of proteins, this could downstream lead to our ability to engineer any type of potent vaccine against any infectious disease, which now we're beginning to see the fruition of that idea in the application of COVID. But beyond vaccines, you could use this, create protein replacement therapies to address any type of disease and therapeutic. You could develop this into targeted immunotherapies to treat cancer, regenerate organs through the application of the original science, and again, target any type of intracellular drug target as well. And so vast, diverse, and massive application and value pools that could be unlocked through the proper science and IP creation of an early company in this space. Next slide, please. Maybe I'll skip through this just for the sake of time. But again, beyond this, the early company needs to begin to imagine what are the baseline experiments that need to be conducted. For an investor that's outside of the scientific space, this could be hard to imagine, but it's important to be able to work alongside the right scientific KOLs and stakeholders to ensure that the companies we're watching are actually conducting the right experiments that enable the right IP portfolio. And this is an incredibly important practice that we undertake at Flagship. And next slide. And I'll skip through this as well, but essentially this is just walking through how Moderna moved through the various phases that we imagine within the biotech life cycle from pre-2010, when the original academic research was being conducted, to the ideation that was happening with Flagship, to the founding of that company at Flagship, and all the way to where it is today, and all the immense number of partnerships and applications that it's able to pursue. And then the last slide I'll just close this presentation with is that Moderna is one example of many other companies that we can imagine in our outside of Flagship's ecosystem where biotech companies could create value. This has been a growing prominent field within the US, but within Canada, we're beginning to see a lot of activity that's emerging in Toronto, Montreal, Vancouver, Hamilton, where therapeutic companies have the potential to overtake any other industry, not only because of the kind of value that it creates, but because of the kinds of problems that it's solving, where we're beginning to realize the world doesn't just need, say, another dating app, but the world needs more medicines and more people that could back the creation of that. So yeah, with that, I'll end this talk and happy to discuss further with Patrick.
Yeah, wonderful. Thank you for that, Michael. And I wanted to focus on the IP portion of this for our audience in terms of, I thought it was interesting you mentioned operating under stealth and secrecy. Obviously, there's trade secrets that haven't come to full fruition. But in terms of the life cycle of one of these companies and when they are looking to go to market to raise equity, to raise debt, to borrow funds, is that not until a stage where there is something relatively fully formed that they can present as value to an investor or a lender? Or are they still possibly wanting to rely on some trust and the reputation of principals and maintain some secrecy around the actual technology at that time?
Yeah, great question, Patrick. So this is one of those questions where it does depend a little bit, I think, on the kind of company you're working with and the kind of investor that you're dealing with as well. But we see examples of it all across the board, across biotech. There are examples of founders that are already taking pre-established IP that was created and within the university, working with the tech transfer offices, and then building the companies around an IP portfolio that's already established. For some investors, this is the only kind of company they're willing to work with. But we're beginning to see more and more that there are founders that are raising funds, early seed funds, and even Series A on the basis of compelling ideas that if they were able to create a particular strategy around the IP or the product in this space, they are able to begin to raise large amounts of money. And part of the reasons for that is that science, again, is hard to predict, but does depend on the individual being the right individual to have the ideas and vision for the kinds of science that they can create. And so a lot of the times, I think, to more practically answer your question, at the Series A, founders oftentimes do need to have at least a portfolio or a presentation of a strategy of the portfolio that they're beginning to secure, whether it's at the provisional stage or already secured patents, granted patents. And at the Series A, that's incredibly important because, again, the company has no products at that stage. So the entirety of the value of the promise of that future of that company is resting upon the IP that they're generating at that stage.
Right. And in terms of actually ensuring protection of their IP, is there a culture of racing to get patents registered or ensuring things are protected by copyright?
Yeah.
Are founders hyper-conscious of the issues of protection of IP, and how do they sort of view that part of their business growth?
100%. And for better or worse, this has probably been, one of the central controversies within the biotech as well, is that a lot of the times early stage biotech companies come across as incredibly secretive. And science as a whole, I think, could benefit from individuals being a little bit more open as well. So not to say that I'm proposing that, we should change the way it is. It's hard to say. It's a complex issue. There is probably parts by which biotech companies could become more open with the kinds of science that they're conducting to ensure that, the world is buying into the kind of impact they're hoping to create for them. But at the same time, IP is a very sensitive issue for the biotech companies because science, even within academia, a lot of the times professors are racing to get the papers published first. Biotech companies are racing to get the patents first. And we've seen even within our own companies as well, if you are slow by 1 to 2 weeks, sometimes you miss the priority date and you lose out to another company that just filed right before you. So yes, it is many times a race to be able to get the patent secured, to be able to execute on the patent, to create the products. And as well, a lot of times these companies operate in stealth for that very reason.
Very good. Well, I think this is a great transition point to our next speaker to talk about how they would view sort of the founders and builders of these companies from a lending perspective. So I just want to thank you, Michael, for your fascinating presentation that with real world effects, obviously, happening from where you're coming from. So thanks again. And again, to our audience, if you have any questions or like to reach out to Michael, I'm sure he'd be happy to do so after the presentation or into the future. So thanks again, Michael.
Thank you very much, Patrick.
Okay, so I'd like to welcome our next speaker to the stage, Lally Rementilla, who is the managing partner, intellectual property-backed financing at BDC Capital. She oversees and provides strategic guidance to a national team that helps IP-rich companies become global leaders by accelerating their growth and commercialization of their innovation. So Lally has decades of experience in the technology sector as an executive on the investor side of things and on the lending side of things. So maybe I'll ask her to give a bit of a brief intro during her answer to this, to our first topic of her experience and what she brings to the table. And I wanted to, on top of that, maybe Lally, start by talking about what it means to be focusing on lending to businesses on the basis of valuable IP and security rather than accounts receivable, tangible assets, real estate, things that maybe people are more familiar with an usual lending in commercial space.
Well, first of all, thank you very much, Patrick, and thank you, Gowlings, for the invitation. And great work, Michael. I think you set a real good stage for the journey that a biotech company goes through and the decisions that need to be done or made along the way. So so IP-backed financing, I guess that's what I eat, live, and breathe these days. And I think I want to first start off with defining it because it does have different connotations to the market. But simply put, intellectual property-backed financing is an investment process where the lender attributes value to both the tangible and intangible assets of the company. And so in the case of intangible assets, which could be in the form of intellectual property rights, which would be patents, trademarks, trade secrets, and copyright, intangible assets also includes data, know-how, brand, and other forms of intellectual capital, as well as contracts. The global economy nowadays is more geared towards value generated from intangible assets. As some of you may already know, more than 90% of the value of the S&P 500 is actually driven by companies that have those rich intangible asset bases. So the irony, you see companies being driven by intangible assets. From a lender's perspective, it's just so frustrating to see that a lot of these companies are still being valued from a security perspective or from a credit perspective based on their tangible assets. And so back in July 2020, the Business Development Bank of Canada launched an intellectual property-backed financing fund to address the issues around how do we get sufficient, if not impactful, capital to these IP-rich companies in order to see them accelerate the rate in which they're commercializing their innovation. So if you look at what Michael just discussed, it's how do you get phase three and phase four companies the right capital in order to make them grow? So in order to do this, we set up this fund, and it's the first of its kind in Canada, and very different from what you may see from a traditional, let's say, lending fund or even an equity fund. The first thing to notice, first of all, we're very sector and industry agnostic. So we can make investments, and that can be in the form of both debt and equity across any industry or sector. It doesn't need to be a scale-up or technology company. It can be a more traditional company, such as a manufacturing company, where we see that the company has invested in that intellectual property strategy and has the makings of a portfolio that can make them essentially leap beyond their competition. We do see a lot of companies more so in more hardware-driven industries. So we see a lot of companies in medical technologies, biotech, advanced manufacturing, semiconductors, clean tech, ag tech, and even some consumer products. And it's a solution that we believe fills the gap in the lending environment that we have right now in Canada. The other note about intellectual property-backed financing and the way we do it at the BDC is that we're trying to come up with a customized financial solution because we know that companies that have rich intellectual property portfolios are different from each other. They may have different stages of growth. They may have different maturities when it comes to the products and services that they offer. And they may be capitalized differently. Some of them could be venture-backed, and some of them may not be venture-backed. Some of them may be bootstrapped along the way. And so we've been able to develop a process where we work with a company to understand their financial strategies and their financial needs. And then from there, propose a customized term loan solution or a convertible note, or even participate in a minority equity financing. What makes this fund different among everyone else as well is the fact that we do have that focus on analyzing and valuing the company's intellectual property portfolio. So the history of this fund is that a team was actually brought in. So I used to be the CEO of another alternative lender called Quantius, which in 2016 started doing IP-backed loans. So my entire team was brought into the BDC because we recognized that we needed specific expertise from a company that knew the IP markets, could work very well with a variety of IP-rich companies. And so we brought that investment process in. And it is this investment process that we're using to go deep into understanding these intellectual property portfolio and how it aligns very closely to their commercial and business strategy. We also go as far as running a valuation on their patent portfolio, as well as trying to understand the value that the trade secrets or copyrights or trademarks that they already have registered, and try to understand how those can be put together to provide some strength in the company that makes them truly creditworthy from our perspective. So the kinds of companies that we work with, so that the typical client profile would be a company, let's say that it's in Michael's portfolio. So a company that has what we call an emerging or established IP portfolio that includes a richness of patents, copyrights, trademarks, trade secrets, and a strong IP strategy. The second thing is that we do, especially from a lending perspective, do realize that we don't take on commercialization risk. And so we want to see companies that have already commercialized their intellectual property, whether it be through product sales, services sales, or the licensing of their IP revenues or IP portfolio. And then third, we believe that IP is a global market, and it's really a global asset. And so we look for companies that are looking to go global and have the ambition, the plan, and the execution skills to be a leader in their space.
Thanks, Lally. That's a great overview. And I do want to focus on this issue of, people looking at the credit risk of a company and a lender going out there and talking with a company about maybe being able to provide some financing and support for them, but also being worried about convincing their own credit risk team that there is value in the IP assets. So when you're sitting down with a potential borrower, one of these companies, what are you hoping to see from them sort of tangibly to convince you and give you the ammunition you need to provide a convincing picture, or to provide any lender with a convincing picture to their credit risk team that there is value there, and there's value that can be realized if in an enforcement scenario?
Correct. So very good question. So as I mentioned, a lot of more traditional lending is really more focused on what the balance sheet has. And unfortunately, that doesn't make sense for IP-rich companies. There obviously have been innovations in the space. So there's venture debt lending, there's recurring revenue financing that tries to mimic or tries to at least find ways of lending to these IP-rich companies. But the way we see it is that when we underwrite a loan, or if a company comes to us and I try to explain the process to them, as we're looking at the loan, it's really an exercise of, obviously, as a lender, identifying ways in which we get paid back. And in order to get paid back, we look at it in terms of what are the possible future exits for us and for the company and its investors as well. So how do you create an exit? How do you create a great news story for this company? And we bring it down to a very simple concept, which is called product market moat fit. For those in the technology and venture capital circles, I think everyone has heard of the term product market fit, and it's coming up with a very strong product that's addressing the need of a fast, large, and growing market. Well, we at our team, we add another dimension to that, and it's the creation of a moat. So how do you create a moat for that market share? How do you make it difficult for your competitors to compete against you? And how do you ascertain that you're always innovating and always having a way to differentiate yourself against your competition and within the market and against even your substitutes along the way? By having that product market moat fit, we believe that it creates a lot more exits for a company. And so an exit can be in the form of cash flow generation. So how is this patent protected product able to increase the company's ability to generate future cash flows? Exits can also be in the case of refinancing. So as the company grows, how can we graduate this company to a more senior lender? An exit through a sale of the company. So how has the value of this IP portfolio independent of the market that it's in, how does that create value for potential acquisition of another company, whether it be a competitor or an adjacent, even a supplier for, let's say, or customer down the road? And then obviously putting on our risk management hat, it's how do you create an exit through liquidation? So how convinced are you that there's a market for this intellectual property portfolio if on the downside scenario you need to enforce on your loan? So it's our belief that when you have that IP portfolio, you are creating a lot more of those exit scenarios because IP rights help you create a monopoly and discourage competition. So again, it helps create more future cash flow in the future. Companies that have strong IP rights can also increase their prices because they have something unique enough in order to truly differentiate them from the market and hold their customers really close to each other. As an example, we have companies in our portfolio that were affected by the semiconductor shortage that we are seeing right now, but are actually able to raise their prices up even 20% in order to pass along some of that, I guess, the increase in costs that they have. The other thing is IP rights actually help lower costs as well. So it increases the rate in which a company can get a new product out to market if they're savvy enough to be able to work with other companies and their IP along the way. And it can also help them, especially when you have a very strong brand, reduce your cost of acquisition. And I guess lastly, the other thing to note is that IP rights also can help a company attract further investment and make them easier to, whether it to be raise other forms of loans or in some cases more growth oriented equity financing. And so by looking at all these areas, whether as to how that IP portfolio can help generate those different exit scenarios, that's what gives us comfort in lending to a company. And that's what obviously gives us comfort in underwriting the loan.
Right. And that does sound somewhat, you know, it takes some specialized knowledge maybe to be able to confidently lend on these assets. And that takes me to something that we see often, which is sometimes we may have a senior lender who is lending on more traditional assets, and either the company or there can be a pitch to find a way to get the company, you know, access to more credit by finding a different lender who will actually place, you know, primary value on the IP assets. So mm-hmm. we face these sort of priority agreements where one lender takes priority on one type of asset and other lenders take priorities on other types. Can you talk about your experience in terms of, is it very complicated to get an interlender agreement in place where we're separating the IP assets from the tangible assets? And what sort of factors should even the traditional lenders think about when an IP lender, let's call them, is coming in and providing additional financing?
Very good question. So from our experience, well, first of all, before I answer that, it's interesting to note that the role of the BDC is to be a complementary lender in the market. So it is our role to support companies in earlier stages of development and to de-risk them for all of the other financial stakeholders, whether it be their senior lender, whether it be their equipment lender, their shred lender, and obviously it's their equity investors. So by coming in, we're performing a service because we go really deep into understanding another aspect of the company that we know all the other finance or funding providers don't. And so that gives us greater insight on the future potential and the strength of the company that we're essentially passing along. The conviction that we have into making a loan to the company gives the company the ability to raise money from other sources. Now, when it comes time where we are in a particular situation where there are other lenders on the table, then we look at it from the perspective of what are the lenders actually valuing, and let's give that to them. So when we work with senior lenders that have, valued the company or have given them a line of credit or an operating line subject to against or margins against their AR inventory, then definitely like that's something that we say, take that, we'll subordinate to you on that. And that obviously also happens in the case where a company has maybe a shred loan or equipment financing. Where we see, again, the value of the company is in that IP portfolio. And therefore, in most cases, because what we really want to try to do is create a lot of cushion for that company, is that we're coming in with larger checks. So our check sizes are somewhere between $3 to $10 million, and that could be for early stage companies. And we believe that that provides a lot of safety for all the other lenders in the table. And the more intimate relationship that we have a company where we're essentially providing them financial discipline in the form of monthly reporting, in the form of semi-annual IP portfolio reviews, gives other lenders the comfort that someone is there to keep their facility safe because we're actually working with a company to make sure that there's financial discipline. Now, in the case of how does it come about, it's really just a very simple subordination agreement subject to a general security agreement. Like we don't go to a lot of sort of complexity in the process, especially when we're looking at very early stage companies. So happy to obviously just be subject to a GSA, and then we work out the agreement with the other lenders as to how the seeding of rank happens.
Right. So, and on another sort of similar note of you know, there's competition between lenders, but there may also be competition for these companies between lenders and investors. And can you talk about maybe your experience, or like, are you in the business of trying to convince potential borrowers that borrowing is the way to go? You can retain equity in your company and we can support you and you don't need to give up a stake in your company? Or is that, are there factors like that you face in meetings with potential borrowers? Mm-hmm.
So first and foremost, we're risk managers. And so when we look at an opportunity to work with a company, we try to understand where in the spectrum this company sits, whether they're on the debt risk end or the equity risk end. And so it is our role to almost educate the company into really understanding how they can have a strong balance sheet. And that is the reason why we're able to make investments all across the capital stack. And so it's an ongoing conversation with a company to really understand their needs. And for the most part, the needs of their existing financial stakeholders as well, because they may have equity investors, they may have angel investors, and they may have existing lenders as well. But I would say the rule of thumb is when we look at an opportunity, we first and foremost identify is this equity risk? Is this equity risk? In which case, then when we work with a company, then we're structuring something, let's say something like convertible note or a pure minority equity financing. And where we see a lot more predictability in the company's ability to generate those future cash flows, and then that gets us closer to a debt investment.
Right. Okay. Thank you for that. And I just want to, so I see we've got a question in the chat here, and maybe you can decipher it for us. So at what size does a patent portfolio go from being big to being IP rich? And is there a lower threshold?
Very good question. So it's not a question of the number of patents. We've seen companies that have large portfolios where it's not truly rich from our perspective. And the reason for that is that the patents don't necessarily support the products and services that they offer in the market currently. And the flip side, we've seen companies that have only one patent, and the strength of that patent and how it protects their technology and innovation and how it makes them truly differentiated in the market would, from our perspective, deem them to be an IP-rich company. So what's very important, and the way we do our qualification process, is that first and foremost, we actually sit down with the company and we examine their portfolio and ask them to map that portfolio to their products and services. And that's where we get a better understanding of how truly IP rich that company is.
Okay, excellent. So we have about 10 minutes left, and I want to make sure we leave enough time for Alex. Is there anything further that you wanted to mention that we didn't get to in this discussion that you think might be relevant to our audience?
Yes, well, first and foremost, I think that this is a great community, and I'm really happy that you're able to bring or put forward the discussion topic of intellectual property and technology. And as a lending community, I think we should all collaborate with each other and find ways to support these companies. So I'm very much open to having conversations with the other lenders in this team, in this group, obviously the lawyers as well. You can always reach me at, bdc.ca/IP. That's our website.
Okay, wonderful. Thanks again, Lally, for your time. We really appreciate it. And that was an insightful discussion.
Thank you very much.
Okay, for our final portion of this presentation, we're going to bring up our very own Alex Ross, who's going to talk about the time after we've had the founding of the company, we've had the risk assessment, and now it's time for the lender to be concerned about making sure that they're properly securing their security interest in intellectual property. So Alex has prepared a presentation, and as always, I'll be watching the Q&A. If there's any questions, I'll pop back on at the end. So thanks again for joining us, Alex.
Thank you very much, Patrick. So we're going to do a whirlwind tour of security interests in intellectual property. So we'll move on to the first slide, please. I'm going to talk about the different types of intellectual property that are out there. First is trademarks, which indicates the source of goods or services. You're typically going to see this be a word or a logo or a symbol. It can also include the shape of a product or the packaging, and in some cases it can include sound. A trademark can be either registered or unregistered. Next slide, please. Copyright protects against copying of particular forms of expression, and it includes music, visual images, movies, and computer programs. Importantly, it only protects the form of the expression and not the underlying idea. It can be registered, but registration's not mandatory. Next slide, please. An industrial design, which in the United States is called a design patent, protects how a product looks, the ornament, but does not protect how it works. These are almost always going to be registered, subject to a small exception for Europe. Next slide, please. Patents are a government-granted monopoly that extends for a limited period of time, and this is how you protect the functional features of a product. The product has to be new, inventive, and useful, and these are always going to be registered. They may not be published, but they will always be registered with an appropriate patent office. Next slide, please. And trade secrets. Trade secret is information that's only known inside of a company and that gives that company an economic advantage over its competitors and that cannot be easily ascertained by the competitors. For example, you can't reverse engineer it. These can be technological or non-technological, like the KFC recipe or the Coca-Cola formula. You will never have a trade secret registered because that would essentially defeat the purpose. Next slide, please. If we're taking security interest in intellectual property, you can have either a general clause that grants a security interest over all of the intellectual property, or you may only take an interest in some types of intellectual property. You might, for example, take a security interest in the patents, but not the trademarks. In addition to that general language, you're also going to want to set out the application and registration number of any registered intellectual property, as well as the title. For intellectual property that isn't registered, that's typically copyright and some common law trademarks, you want to have enough information to identify that property, or alternatively, you can register it, and I'll mention that a little bit later. Next slide, please. Now, trade secrets can be tricky. You want to include enough information to identify what the trade secret is, but be very careful that you do not accidentally disclose it in that document. You'll also want to consider entering into a binding side agreement with those individuals within the borrower who actually know the trade secret that will require them to provide the relevant information and material if you have to enforce on your security. For trademarks, another tricky point is you'll want to make sure that you're not only taking a security interest in the trademark, but also in all of the associated goodwill. If you don't have both of those things together, trying to enforce the security on a trademark without taking the goodwill with it can actually invalidate that trademark. Next slide, please. When we record the security interest, we're going to record it in the relevant PPSA registries as we usually would. For registered intellectual property, you'll also want to record it at the Canadian Intellectual Property Office, which we call CIPO. And you'll want to consider if you have important unregistered intellectual property, such as copyright or common law unregistered trademarks, making it a condition of the loan that you actually register or apply to register those IP rights. For trademarks and copyright, that can be done electronically by a qualified trademark agent or lawyer, and it can be done, at least applied for, very quickly. You'll also want to consider if there are other jurisdictions. Patents, for example, are national in scope, and you'll want to record that security interest anywhere that the security or the intellectual property rights are registered. Next slide, please. One of the main reasons we want to record that security interest in the intellectual property offices, such as CIPO or the USPTO, is that in many cases where the debtor may try to sell that intellectual property, the buyer may not go and check the local PPSA registries. They may only look at the intellectual property office, whether it's USPTO or CIPO. And having that registration on file will significantly reduce the likelihood that you have a buyer who purchases without any notice of the security. That's particularly important under patents because Section 49, Subsection 4 of the Canadian Patent Act, and I've just got the quote there, basically provides that if you have a buyer who purchases from the seller and the security interest or the previous sale is not registered, then it will become void against that subsequent purchaser as soon as they register. So there is a risk that if you've not recorded your security interest, it may be held void against a subsequent purchaser who did not have notice. And that concludes our very quick overview of taking a security interest in intellectual property. Thank you for your time.
Wonderful. Thank you for that, Alex, and great timing. So we want to make sure everybody has time to get to lunch and has time to participate in the mingling section that will be open to you between 12 and 1. So I want to thank again our speakers for that insightful discussion. And again, once we exit this, you will be automatically dropped into the virtual networking room where you can choose to participate or not. And if you turn your camera on, and you can basically double click to any of the seats or tables to see who's there and begin discussions. Otherwise, there will also be a help desk table that you will see. If you're having any technical difficulties, we encourage you to discuss with our help desk team. So thank you again for joining us this morning. And just to let everyone know, the formal stage presentation that you see here will restart up again at 1 p.m. with the remainder of the sessions. So thank you again.